dynamics, we have created R and S such that you can apply the Holder's inequality. So the integral of f to p can be written in this manner, and with this R and this S, which is, I must write a bit more clearly, 1 minus p over q reciprocal. So with these two exponents, I can write this integral, or I can estimate this integral by these two integrals. And once you have this, so this thing is equal to, so just treat this as an aside note. So this would be equal to, this is equal to what? Integral of f over q, over q,
or you measure when the,
or you like a mu of x, 1 minus p over
q
power. So you get that. And in other words, now think about it. So this estimate tells you, if this guy is finite, so every f from LQ for which this is finite, so since I can estimate this guy by this expression, so this must be finite. In other words, we started from, I must write it. So from this estimate, so from estimate, it follows, so what follows? It follows that if f is in LQ, then f must be in LPL. Because if f is in LQ, this guy is finite. And this is also finite, so the product is finite. And hence, since this is estimated by this number, so this must be finite. So what does this mean? That every LQ, every element of LQ is in LPL. So, interesting conclusion result. Convexity of LP0. What do I mean by this? So, calculate this. Take these bunch of numbers. So, take P that is bigger than or equal to Q. And take and Q that is bigger than P, and R is something in between them, and Q is finite. Now if F is in the intersection of LP and LQ, f is an intersection of LP and LQ, then f is going to be in LR, where R can be any number between P and Q. Think about it. What does this result is telling you, that if f is in L2 and L20, okay, then f is in all values from ranging from not excluding 2 and 20. Not only 3, but three could be fraction actually. P could be fraction, R could be fraction. And this is true for finite measure spaces. Okay. Well, this is a generic result. And we can also prove this estimate that the log of the orth norm of f can be written as 1 over r minus 1 over p 1 over q over 1 over p minus 1 over q. Very nicely you can estimate plus p minus 1 over r over 1 over p minus 1 over q of log of norm of f q. Okay? So in other words, if f is in both LP and LQ, then the R norm of f can be estimated by the exponential, if you think about it, by the exponential of this side actually. R norm can be estimated by P and Q norm. So if these guys are finite, looks a difficult result, but it's really simple. Okay. There's a proof. And can you see that why they are calling it convexity? So the convexity is coming, so convexity is in the sense of indices actually. So convexity is what? So you take, you take 2 points, okay? Convex subset, convex set actually. So you take 2 points and then you can join them with a segment, and that segment is entirely is in this way. So it's really unlocked with it. So if it is, if a property is inherited by P and Q, then it would be inherited by all numbers between P and Q actually. Okay. That's what this is coming. See, reflecting over things is also important, otherwise these are a bunch of symbols. What these theorems are telling is an important thing. So, since P is less than Q, less than R, so I can say that 1 over Q is less than 1 over R and less than 1 over P. If 1 over r is between 1 over p and 1 over p, so there exists a theta. Tell me that, you know, reasoning basically that why this should exist. There exists a theta, a number theta, such that it must be between 0 and 1 actually as well. Yes, it must be between 0 and 1, such that 1 over r can be written as theta times p plus 1 minus theta over q. Why is that case? How can we guarantee the existence of such a thing? So see, we proved, we know that the open interval is a convex set actually. It's a convex set. So what does it mean? So take any point from x, you can find always a t between 0 and 1. Such that this x can be written as the combination something similar. So it's convexity of the interval that is giving you this theta. But for the Holder's inequality, you must have a one norm here, not a odd norm. So can I turn this into a one norm? So this is what? So this is the integral, okay? And this is the integral of f theta times f, so 1 minus theta,
whole power,
okay, so whole power r and everything
1 over r.
Okay? So I can write this as, so how can I convert it? Okay. So can I say that this is same as f to the r theta times f to the r 1 minus theta, okay, and everything for 1 bar. Okay? And now treat this as f to the r theta times f to the r times 1 minus theta 1 norm and the power 1 bar. Okay? Because if I just treat these two as integrals, so functions, and I have the integral of the product of two functions, that's basically L1 norm of, so that's the L1 norm of these two functions. And the 1 over r is there actually. So just, you know, I have changed it physically but not chemically. Huh? So chemically is still the same thing actually. Okay. So you might see a physical look, you know. These two things really different, but they are the same actually. Okay. And with this, now since I have L1 norm, so I can apply the Holder's inequality. So the Holder's inequality is going to give me, so this 1 over r is, you know, outside. The Holder's inequality is going to give me, so these are the exponents actually for the Holder's inequality. So it's going to give me what? It's going to give me f r theta of p over r theta norm. If you want to understand it, so fg, okay, fg 1 norm is less than or equal to p norm of f times g norm of q at q norm of g. That's what the what you call the Holder's inequality is actually. Okay. So the p and q are conjugate exponents. That's what the, so I'm saying that take p to be rp over theta and q to be r over 1 minus theta and f to be this guy, f to the r theta and f to be r 1 minus theta. So you can have this. So you can have what? F r 1 minus theta and what now?
Q
over r minus theta. So the q over r 1 minus theta. Okay? Almost done. Very good.
Raised to
r theta over p. So this is equal to what?
F
factor is the pth norm. Okay. Can I say? Okay, so I'm directly writing. It's the pth norm of f raised to r theta. Okay. Pth norm. So r theta, r theta get cancelled. So you have a 1 over p here. So you have f raised to p and 1 over p. So that's the pth norm and raised to r theta. So if I return back to what do we say? Inequality. So this the first integral is that the first norm becomes what? F. The pth norm of f raised to r theta, and the other would be the pth norm of or the qth norm of and r times 1 minus theta. R times 1 minus theta, alright? And if I simplify it and I use this inequality, so what I'm gonna get? I don't need this inequality. So it's gonna get rid of r theta. So f and the p norm raised to what? Theta times f raised to 1 minus theta n theta. Okay?
Log
of Pythagorean. Log of Pythagorean, you get it.
Theta. That's it.
This will be easy. This.